Good morning. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church. We're glad you're joining us online and in person. I do have a few announcements, and kind of the first one is a little apparent. Roberta is not going to be able to join us today. They say when it rains, it pours. Well, she's had a tsunami this last week. She had some testing done, upper GI, so her throat was very sore. Her mother, if you haven't heard, they have found a mass. And so they're kind of dealing with that. And her aunt passed away. And they have asked that Roberta give the eulogy this afternoon. So between her voice and the time, she just wasn't able to join us. And she'll be here in spirit, but we'll keep her and her whole family in our prayers. I do have a few other things. Some of them are on the back of your bulletin. And if you're online, you can get this on our Facebook page. But the food box, I look back there, there's only a couple of cans in there, so we need more food. We have a food box in the parking lot, so anybody that wants to can come and take it whenever. And honestly, I've been here several times in the evening, and I'll see a dozen people walk by, and they'll take one thing or two things. So it's been a huge blessing for our community. So if you can bring in canned goods, there's a whole list back there of things that they can use. And Laundry Day is coming up, as well as Community Meals. So those are both on the second Tuesday and second Saturday. So those will be coming up. This week is our ad board. So if you are on the ad board, you need to attend. Ad board is always open to anyone. So if you want to join, feel free to come. We do usually meet in the parlor. And the last one, I'm going to put her on the spot a little bit. I received an email from Diana that Grace Church is having their May breakfast. And that's this Tuesday. Okay, so if you couldn't hear, it's at Grace Church, this Tuesday morning at 9, but you just need to let Diana know so that they can make some reservations. I think those are all of the announcements. I will share, before we get there, we are not going to be doing communion today, since Pastor Roberta's not here, so we're just going to postpone that. Now, some of our liturgy kind of ties into communion. So just go with it, but we will be doing communion next week. So I think we're ready to start. Thank you. Would you stand and join me in the opening hymn?
Please join me in the invitation to worship, also the affirmation of faith. In turbulent times, when the knot of fear tightens, when doubt needles us and despair encircles us, as depression threatens to sink us, and grief tries to bury us.
Trust God, follow Jesus, and sing your song.
Now we sing of our faith and rejoice together in this celebration. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in His Son, Jesus Christ? Do you believe and trust in His Holy Spirit?
I
Amen. Okay, now it's time for the children to come forward.
How are you guys? Good. You got your cousins here. Life's good, isn't it? All right, we're going to talk about a couple of different things. So, what's this? Do you guys know what these are?
Bubbles.
Bubbles. Let's see if I can find it in here. Look at these bubbles. Woo! Those are pretty, aren't they?
Hey, they're still water.
They are. That's unusual. They usually just... I know. Here, you want to wipe them off?
No.
Okay. Well, bubbles are pretty, aren't they?
Yeah.
But they're pretty insubstantial. You know what that means? They kind of break apart. As soon as they touch the ground, they're going to break apart, don't they?
Yeah, but
it's stuck that time.
Yeah.
Yeah, you pop it. What did you start to say? You started to say something, and Warren beat you to it. No? Okay. Well, bubbles are really, they're pretty, but you can see right through them, can't you? Now, we're going to talk about rocks today in church, so I thought I'd bring some rocks. Do you know what this guy is? It's just a rock, isn't it? Yeah?
It's heavy, it's hard to break, and you can see through it, not at all.
It will break if you get a hammer and smash it.
If you get a hammer and smash it on there.
It would definitely break.
It would probably break. But if you broke it with a hammer, what happened
like
to it?
It's like a giant heavy peanut.
It does kind of look like that. You're right.
If you hammer it, then it'll go
actually, you guys are going to keep those.
Pieces.
If you hammer it, it's going to break into little pieces. What if we had John come down here with some of his rock cutting stuff and he cut it open for us? You think it'd be prettier?
No,
you don't know?
There might be something in.
That's exactly it, because inside these
There's
are supposed
like
to be...
things like crystals.
Exactly. So that's what should be inside of these, or it should be crystals inside. And so if he cut it for us, then we would be able to see inside. But right now, we can't see inside, can we?
Yeah, because it's put together.
It's all stuck together, you're right. But God can see inside us, so we're kind of like these rocks. On the outside, we all kind of look about the same. Actually, you guys, well, we have one blonde hair down here. All the rest of you are even dark-haired, so we all look pretty much the same, don't we? Well, you hang on. I'll get you to the bubbles in a minute. So inside, though, we're each different, aren't we? And God understands that, and he can see inside of us. Just like we can't see inside that rock until we cut it open, God doesn't have to cut us open. He can see inside, and he knows what we need, and he helps to polish us up. So if we polish those rocks and cut them open, they might look really pretty, okay? So when you think about bubbles and rocks, I want you to think about you and God, because you're kind of that rock. Bubbles we can see through, but they're pretty insubstantial. They're going to pop. The rock's going to be here for a long, long time, and I want you guys to be here.
What is the bubble like?
What is the bubble like? Well, it's a sphere of soap.
No, I mean, we're talking about, like, the rocks being like us.
Oh, okay, if the rocks are like us, I don't know. What would not stick around very long? What wouldn't be worth too much effort putting into it? I don't know. You'll
maybe
have to
like
think about that.
Insects or something?
an insect. They don't stick around very long, do they? But they do a good job. So I don't know. We'll have to think about that a little bit. The bubbles are all different colors. All right. Can you give a couple more bubbles down there?
Yeah.
Okay. No, he's got one. You got one more. Okay. Everybody's got bubbles. Everybody's got a rock. He's got his rock. He's on down there. Give him a bubble. There you go. Okay. So will you play with me real quick? Okay. Thank you, dear Lord, for loving us so much that you're willing to have us be special in your world. Have us be something more than just a bubble that just floats away. Help us to see inside, that we can see the beautiful crystals that you have planted in us, and help us to understand how you're shining us up each time something kind of bad happens to us, because we know that you love us so much that you want us to be the best person that we can be. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. Okay, you can all go. Can y'all get your rocks?
Thank you.
Time where we're going to share some of our joys and some of our concerns. If you're online, please feel free to add those things in the comment section so that we can add those to our prayer list this coming week. You heard about Pastor Roberta, lots of pieces there to pray for. And Ben lost his grandfather, so please add Ben and his family to your prayers. Are there other prayers or updates on any of the prayers, concerns that we've had? Or joys that you want to share? All right. I will say it if you all won't, but the Abbeys are back. To me, that's kind of a joy. Yes, we are thrilled to have you back in Elwood. Okay, so for the shooting that was in Texas. And the really sad part is that we've had so many that it's kind of like we've lost track of which one it is. And as much as we think about these being in the U.S., they're not. Just recently, we've had several around the world. So keep both sides of that, because there's something truly wrong, and they need to be touched to be healed, the people who are doing the shooting, and obviously the people who have suffered through.
And we're thankful for Charlotte's point.
Yeah.
Yes, we are. And that reminds me, Shelley is also obviously out. Her bronchitis has kicked back up. So allergy season's never an easy time. Anything else? Well, join me in prayer then. We'll start with silent prayer, and I will end with the corporate prayer, and then we will say the Lord's Prayer together. Dear Heavenly Father, there is so much pain and suffering in our world, and sometimes we don't understand. We don't understand how you could let this happen. We don't understand why don't you stop it. But in reality, you're always there. You're always part of every situation. Help us to open our hearts and our minds to see your presence in each of those. Help us to understand how you would have us serve in those situations. Sometimes it's just our prayers, and sometimes it's our hands and feet that need to be part of the solution. Please be with each of these people that we've raised up today and those that we haven't mentioned. Help them to feel your presence in their life, because that we know is the healing balm that we each need. And be with all of the people around the world as they face a lot of hardship. And then they have little pieces of joy in the middle of this, and they sometimes feel bad about having that joy. but we know that you want us to be happy. So help each of us find your joy in our life, that we can share that with each of the people that you bring into our world, just as Jesus shared the joy of his presence with everyone. Now join me in the Lord's Prayer, please. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And unfortunately, we will not be having a choir number today, so we're going to go immediately into our time of generosity. And oh, and he's got it up. He was quick on us. So you can give online. You can bring your checks to the church. You can drop it in the offering plate. If you want to support the mission and the ministry of First United Methodist Church, and today I want to talk about the United Methodist Church. Bishop Trimble had a beautiful piece on Facebook that he shared this week, and he talked about why he was a United Methodist. And he made the point that, you know, sometimes he's been at services where the sermon wasn't that good, and he was even the one preaching it. And he said sometimes people are cranky and crabby, but that's not why he's a United Methodist. He's a United Methodist because first he found Christ in the United Methodist Church, and he was able to serve through that church. And he's been able to serve around the world through the United Methodist Church. He serves on the board of Africa University. He's been worked with UMCOR. And many of us have done the same. We've had people in this church that have served on the camp board, that have served at different levels in our conference for United Methodist Women. It gives us the opportunity to look at God's world in a much broader sense. And the United Methodist Church encourages each of us to participate in that world. And I think for me, that's probably the biggest reason that I'm a United Methodist, is because I know this church not only serves me, but serves the entire world and the congregations in that world. And so I think that's special, and that makes us a little unique. So will you stand and join me in the doxology? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this tithes and these offerings, and bless those that have given them. Bless us to see your presence in our community and around the world, and help us to use these funds to serve all of those people that you are showing us that we should be serving, just as Jesus served us. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Would you remain standing for the hymn?
Thank you.
Please remain standing while Emma brings us the scriptures.
The scripture this morning is from Psalm 31, 1 through 5. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. And from Matthew 7, 24 to 29. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. And it fell with a great crash. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks
be to God.
You may be seated now. So I'm guessing a few of you were a little disappointed when you heard I was going to be talking about rocks today. I mean, it's like, yeah, a rock. It doesn't do too much. It doesn't move around. They're usually not very pretty. What's the deal with rocks? But here's the thing. We've got a lot of references to rocks. You just heard a couple in the Bible, right? So this is audience participation, so you got to kind of, we just had our fifth Sunday music celebration, and I want you to think how many songs you can think of that talk about the rock or a rock. Anybody? Rock of Ages. That's one. Nobody else. Rock My Soul. Yep. My Hope Is Built. There's a lot of them. When you really start looking at them, there's a lot of them. And that's because that concept is kind of central to our understanding of God. There's a lot to be said in those songs. And our image of God as our rock, our foundation, is kind of central to a lot of what we talk about. Christ is our solid rock. All other ground is sifting sand. You remember that one? So that's kind of what we're going to talk about. God is our central theme, our tenet of the central part of our life. That's where we are supposed to be building our lives. Because God loves us. He wants the best for us. And no matter how ridiculous we are sometimes, or crabby, or tired, or just too busy to engage, God's always there for us, regardless of what we do. He's always there. He's always present. He always loves us. So that God is the central part of our life, that God is our rock, that's not a big deal. But the bigger question is, which is the real rock? You got some rocks up here that aren't very real. You got a rock up there, Dwayne Johnson, The Rock, if you don't know who. He does wrestling, and now he's an actor. And most actors, as you know, have stunt doubles. Well, this is actually a picture of Dwayne Johnson with his stunt double. A lot of times he uses his cousin as his stunt double. And you dress him up in the same outfit you have him running around all over the place, shooting or blowing things up, and it's pretty hard to tell the difference. for us, sometimes it's hard to tell the difference between the real God and some of the pretend gods that we see. Now, some of them are kind of easy. You know, we think about things like status, money, power, you know, influence. Doesn't matter how many Twitter followers you have, really. We see those as those pretend rocks. And we understand that if we were to try to build our life on that kind of a rock, we wouldn't have a very stable life. We wouldn't have a very happy life. Because God as our rock, the real God, provides us stability, security, but also contentment, even happiness. And all of those pretend rocks, they can't do that for us. But those big pretend rocks, power, status, those are kind of easy. Those are, we can identify those pretty quickly. But how about some of the things that are a little more realistic looking rock? How about knowledge? Shouldn't we understand what God asks us to do? Aren't there truths in our life that we should know? Jesus is our Savior. God is all-powerful, omnipresent, omnipotent. Those are God-given truths. Those are things that the Bible tells us. How about some other truths? How about if you don't believe what I do, you're wrong, and you'll be condemned? Have you ever heard if you're not United Methodist, you'll be condemned? I haven't. But I have heard if you're not Catholic or if you're not from my church. I have heard that before. How about some other truths that we have as Christians? There's a lot of truths that we, the people, have created, like America first. I don't think that's God's truth. How about people really aren't responsible for what they did because they had some injustice in their life, and so that allows them to do anything? There's people that believe that truth. Our knowledge and understanding is limited to what we've seen and done, what we've experienced. So our understanding, our knowledge is pretty limited when you compare that to God, because God has seen and done everything, because he has experienced everything that every person on this world has ever done. He understands things that we will never begin to understand. So when we try to build our rock, our house on knowledge, it's pretty shaky. Let's go back to a Bible reference. What's the very first story in the Bible? Well, Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve and that little serpent that comes along and tells them to what? Eat from the fruit of the tree of knowledge. How'd that work out for him? Not so great, did it? So knowledge, as important as it is, knowledge isn't that rock. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand, because I think it is important. I think it's critical that we understand as much as we can about what God's called us to do, that we read the Bible, that we talk to others so that we can expand that knowledge. But the reality is, that's not our rock. Because here's the reality. As soon as you start saying, well, God says, or God thinks, there's a little thing, the cable guy, y'all know him? That's your sign. That's your sign that you stepped way over that line. Because as soon as you start to speak for God, you've placed him someplace else. You're now the center. Your knowledge base is what you're basing your life on. And that's a pretty narrow base for most of us. So God calls us to understand. God calls us to believe. But first and foremost, I think, God calls us to love. And that's the central theme that I think God bases everything on, is love. Jesus is our perfect love. And when we think about what Jesus did, it's pretty amazing, isn't it? Now, don't get me wrong. I don't think Jesus was a pushover. I don't think Jesus believed just do whatever you want to, whatever makes you feel good. That's definitely not the Jesus that I've ever read about. And he got pretty forceful sometimes. I mean, he went in and threw the money changers out. He didn't go in and nicely ask them to leave. He didn't go in and say, well, I think you need to rethink your life choices. He went in and chucked them out. He threw them out of the temple. He turned over the tables. He demanded that people respect his Father, our Father. So Jesus was not a pacifist. And unfortunately, too many people like to put him over in this little, so we'll just, we can do whatever we want. That's not at all what Jesus was. But Jesus did love everyone. I want to think about a couple other stories that we have about Jesus. How about the time that he healed the soldier? He was defended. His disciple was defending Jesus from arrest. A soldier, a group of soldiers came up. Now, Jesus knew what was happening. He knew what he was going to be experienced. He knew where this was going. And even though he was aware of the humiliation, the pain, the suffering that he was going to face, he still stopped and took the time to heal that soldier. He loved a thief so much that even as he hung on the cross and that thief yelled nasty things at him for hours on end, he still loved him so much that he promised him salvation. He loved a Samaritan woman who came up to a well, and he lowered himself to speak to her. And there's all kinds of things you can think about, but in that society, that was huge. He took the time to love each of those people. Now, he could have easily condemned each one of those people. He had every right to. And they all had done something pretty horrendous. But he didn't. He could have just ignored them. But he didn't do that either. He loved them so much that he was willing to take a little bit of time, a little bit of himself, to provide them comfort. And that's what I think we're supposed to be building our house on. That level of love. When you build your house on that kind of love, everything else changes. Because here's the reality for me. God loves each and every one of us. Not more, not less. But he loves each of us. And sometimes that's kind of hard to wrap your head around, isn't it? Because he loves me, and I feel like I'm a pretty good person. I try to do what God tells me. But he loved that criminal just as much. That's what real love is about. And that's understanding that rock that we have, that no matter what we do, no matter who we are, God takes the time to see us, and he loves us. Now, I'm going to go down a little bit of a rabbit hole. I won't go too far, I promise, because so many people I hear are like, well, fine, if he loves everybody, why should I even bother? Why should I go to church? Why should I read the Bible? Who cares? And this is what I hear, and this is a picture hopefully I can stick in your mind that makes you understand why I don't think that's the reason we love, that we come to God. So most of us have kids. Some of us have grandkids even. So when your kids come home and they give you this big hug, is the first thing out of their mouth what you want to hear is, okay, Mom, I love you so much. How's my inheritance? Is the house still okay? Do you still have that 401k? Yeah. That's not what I want to hear from my kids. But when we go to God and say, God, I'm here in church so that my spot in heaven is saved, that's exactly what we're saying to him. I don't care about your love. I don't care. I just care about what you're going to do for me. And that's not why we come. We come, hopefully, my kids come, because they love me. That's why we come to God, is because we love him. We come to hear what he has to say to us, because we know that rock, the real one back here, is stable. And we know that when we build our life on that rock, that we will have that safety, that comfort. Now, here comes the hard part. Because as much as God loves us and wants the best for us, he also loves all these other people and wants us to love all those other people. And that, in a lot of times, starts to be the hard part, isn't it? Because he doesn't say, love the people that look like me, that come to my church. He loves everybody, whether they look like me, whether they think like me, they act like me. Love everybody. And that love of our neighbors sometimes is hard. But not as hard sometimes as love of our family. Because loving my neighbor is kind of distant, and, you know, most of the time I don't have to get in their face and I don't have to be in their business. But my family, they're in my face, they're in my business, I'm in theirs. It's hard sometimes because you don't like what they're doing. But you still have to love them. And it's hard for us because not only do we have to love them and accept them for the mistakes that they made, we have to live a godly life as an example as well. So it's a double-edged sword. But our family is critical. God tells us to raise our children in the way. So loving our family, loving our neighbors, God calls us to do those things. But he also calls us to love ourselves. Even when we fail, even when we make mistakes, and we all have made mistakes, and I'm pretty sure, unless you're done living, you're probably still going to make a few more. But God expects us to love ourselves. Not ignore them, not act like they didn't happen. Accept them, ask forgiveness, and move forward. So God asks us to always grow. And that's hard sometimes. It's hard sometimes to accept that God can love me when I know I've messed up. But the good news is, he is. He's willing to love each of us. Now, I talked a little bit about Jesus and the sacrifices that he's made. And, you know, there are some movies that I just can't watch anymore because they do the passion that he went through. And that's just hard for me to see. And it's hard for me to understand. But think about where Jesus was. He was willing to do all of that pain and suffering because he did know the real God. He'd met him face to face. So if Jesus is willing to do all of that based on somebody he really knows, I would hope that we're willing to love ourselves, forgive ourselves, love our family, forgive our family, love our neighbors. That's not nearly as much as what Jesus has done. And Jesus has done it because he knows the real God. And I'm hoping that each of us can know that real God through Jesus. So in the week this coming, I'm going to challenge you to look around this world. I want you to look at all the people and see that little bit of God that's in each one of us. and see if you can't find the inside of those rocks where those beautiful crystals are, because that's what God sees in us. And that's what we're building our lives on. So I pray that you will meet and love somebody new this week. Shall we? I think, are we keeping the same one? Sorry. Yes, okay. So stand with me and we're going to sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. May you feel secure in God's love enough that you can reach out and share that love with every person that you meet. Bless and come back and enjoy those fellowship of everyone you meet. We are going to change. We're not playing Trees of the Field. We're going to close with Rock of Ages. Well, oh, my hope is built. There we go.